set included Somebody's Baby from the Fast Times at Ridgemont High soundtrack, Jackson's biggest commercial hit.
Morning light comes streaming in. I'll get up and do it again.
Three of Browne's albums, For Every Man, Late for the Sky, and The Pretender, were selected by Rolling Stone magazine in their 500 best albums of all time. And he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame by Bruce Springsteen.
I know the Eagles got in first, but let's face it, these are the songs they wish they'd written. I wish I'd written them myself.
At the Grammys in 2016, he and the Eagles performed Take It Easy in honor of the late Glenn Frey. Browne remains an active musician and social activist, and has always answered the call, appearing at benefits for friends and causes that matter the most to him.
Let the buildings keep our children drowned.
In the fullness of time, Jackson's songs have become perhaps even more poignant, pertinent, and powerful. It is an honor and privilege to present the 2018 NAMM Tech Les Paul Innovation Award to Jackson Browne.
Did you notice that when Nico played these days, there was that beautiful F major stepping chord I was talking about? You know who played that chord? Fucking Jackson Browne, that's who played it. It's my great pleasure to introduce a man I love and admire, whom we all appreciate, Jackson Browne, the recipient of the award.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Tech, for this incredible honor and for putting me together on the same night with the section. And I think everybody who knows me knows that I'm the furthest thing from a technical person. I know nothing. And that's why it means so much to me to be honored by you, because I've relied on the kindness of engineers and their knowledge of the studio and equipment my whole life. I'm so delighted that Peter got to talk about the section, because I followed him around for a while, for several years, just doing what he did. Hiring who he hired and going to the studios that he hired, because I knew I didn't know. And it led me into the company of the players that you've heard honored here tonight. And a long list of engineers who I'm really fortunate to have gotten to work with. Because I'm not technical in the least. It's absurd that I have a studio. Except that as soon as we started doing shows, as soon as we started making records we liked, we wanted them to sound that way live, and so we started buying stuff. The first thing I ever bought was an LA-2A, out of like a little electronic shop that was attached to Sunset Sound. And I just started, every now and then I'd buy something, and the more money we made, the best two parts about making money is that you can pay your friends more for playing with you, and you can buy stuff, buy gear. And I'm certain that everybody knows more than I do about how to use this gear, but I'm an example of what I think is present in Les Paul's example, you know, which is that he heard something he wanted to get, and he figured out how to get it. And that's as simple as that. I'm the simplest possible. I'm the guy you want to sell your gear to, but you know, first there has to be like a really discerning engineer sitting there next to me, and I'll look at him and say, how can we do this? Or oh, that's great. What did you just do? What was that? And I sort of learned by doing. Most of all, let me just say that for the section, to be a songwriter in LA that wanted to make a record and he could barely sing, he didn't really like the way he sounded when he sang, it meant the world to have Russ Kunkel step up to me one day, because we had some friends in common, and he said, I you wouldn't know unless I told you this, but I want to play on your record, so when you get ready to make your record, be sure you call me, all right? And that led to my getting to play with Leland Sklar, and I think, not to contradict Peter, but I think that the first time Russ Kunkel and Leland Sklar played with Craig Doerge was on my session for Rock Beyond the Water. And I always felt like I had a kind of, a kind of proprietary interest in that band, the section. I knew they were James's band, but it didn't keep me from hiring whenever I could. And it was many years before I could afford to take them on the road. And when I finally could, it was to make Running on Empty. And I did what I had always been doing with. But not to go too long about this, you know, I had to have them. I'd been making records with them for several years. They played on three of my records. They played on my first record, my second album, my fourth album, and I knew I could do this. I had this idea that if I just could record every show, I should record everything, and even what happened backstage, and even what happened, even the conversations that happened on the bus, that I can make something really memorable about what it was like to be a touring musician and what it was like out there. And the first thing I was telling Peter Asher what I wanted to do, and I said, you know, they got some really great cassette recorders now. Maybe we just record everything. Nakamichi's got this great new cassette. And he said, whoa. At least take a two-track. You know, at least take some, you know, like take a Studer or something, or a Revox or something. So he talked me out. And actually, right at that time, Shoko said, well, we got a Studer 24-track. You can take that, and we record every gig. So, I mean, if there's anything innovative that I have done, and there may be one or two things that haven't been done before, it was to take a Studer 24-track, put it in a room, not listen to it, make a live album without ever listening to anything back. Because you just had a guy back there with headphones on, just checking each individual track to make sure it was distorting. The great engineer, Greg Ladani, who had mixed up the Pretender, said he'd get on the headphone and call back to the guy checking that he said he'd noticed that the level might have changed, that Russell wasn't playing the kick as hard. He'd say, what kind of levels do you have on the kick drum? The guy'd say, +3, like you said. And he just knew, he just intuitively, he just run back in there, look at the thing and say, that's not +3, that's +3. And then run back to the front of the house where he was continued mixing the show. And we never listened anything back. But also, we were going to make a double album, and it was going to be a, like every other live album, your chance to re-record the songs you wanted to do better, or do them live, or give people what they'd already heard, but only live. And we started listening to what we had, and it was Russell who said, like after the first show, he said, you know, you should just make this an album of new songs. Just do the new songs. Don't bother redoing the old songs, and you know. That's how we came to make a live album of new songs on stage and in the buses and the backstage. I think that was innovative. Of course, I have to tell you that because everybody here who's younger than me, everybody does that now. Everybody records everything. But at the time, it hadn't been done, and you hadn't been able to do it unless you're willing to make a live album that you don't listen to while you're making. I guess I want to say that the one guy who I really have kind of based almost everything I did on is not here tonight, and that's David Lindley. David Lindley, who gave me the emotional center, gave me the emotional feedback. It was from playing with David that allowed me to to just go by touch, just go by my sense of feel. And once again, without the engineers I've worked with, I couldn't have done that. I mean, all I just wanted to make sure is that people were recording right away, that we were always able to, we captured everything. And when I made a compilation record, I was so proud when I made out the credits to my best work, and I looked at the engineers I'd worked with. I'd worked with John Haney, I'd worked with Al Schmidt, I'd worked with Ed Cherney, I'd worked with Greg Ladani, and I worked with Paul Dieter, I worked with Bob Clearmountain. These people who know everything that I don't know, but who put their technical expertise at the service of the music, at the service of the song. And I'm indebted to them, and I'm indebted to you all, who make the gear that I don't even know how to turn on, but that I could not do anything that I do without. So thank you so much for this award. And I want to dedicate this to Greg Ladani, who would have been here tonight. Whom I miss all the time, and whom I have to share my successes with. This is to Greg Ladani. I want to get the section up here. We'll play a song.
Looking at the moon. you know, everybody knows Booker T. Booker T moved out to the Bay Area. He's in our musicians union, and he's from Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah, he had a giant hit with Green Onions, and we like to pay a little tribute to him with a thing called White Onions. Yeah, it goes like this. Thank you. Time goes real fast. Time goes real fast up here. We want to feature the rhythm section one more time. Yes. Kelly Moore on the drums and Chuck Carter on the percussion. Give it up for Chuck Carter. All right. You heard him on a lot of records, man. All right. What a rhythm section. We're going to bring it down a little bit with the bossa nova that I wrote my first time to Europe. And I flew over there the first time on a Concorde jet. That changed my life. I got there in 3 hours and 26 minutes. Now I'm supersonic. All right. This tune is called Lydia's Tune. I wrote it in my hotel room, one note at a time. It goes like this. Thank you. Merci beaucoup. Takes me back to Paris.